seminar, it's a seminar done, the research was done by students in Mexico, and I'm honored to be able to do the introductory part of the seminar today. And we're going to talk about this amazing research program, Sobre Mexico. Sobre stands for Student Opportunities for Biological Research in Mexico. And the students are going to talk to you about some of their discoveries, and we're going to share with you this program. So there's this place in Mexico where I went when I was a graduate student back in the 80s. It's a biological field station about 120 miles south of Puerto Vallarta on the coast of Jalisco. And it's an incredible place. It's a tropical dry forest. I spent the formative years of my scientific career working in this forest, tracking lizards and other creatures. And you can take a biologist out of the tropical dry forest, but you can never take the tropical dry forest out of a biologist. So I came to Central, but let's talk about what is a tropical dry forest. So there's tropical dry forests are defined by their seasonality. In our system, it will go 6 months, perhaps even longer, with no rainfall. And sometimes those 6 months will be no, it'll be absolute drought. Sometimes it might be a few rains. And then during in the summer, maybe late June, July, the rains come and the forest is transformed from a dry place to a verdant, verdant forest teeming with life. And it's an amazing system. The plants and animals that have evolved in this system have evolved in response to seasonality. And so there's an amazing suite of adaptations of form and structure and ways that the organisms that live here make a living in that forest. And that's part of what we do, is to try to understand how the creatures, how the plants that live in the forest manage their strong seasonality. So I started working there in the 80s, as I said, at this field station. And some of the people in these pictures were my colleagues back then, students like I was, like these guys, just getting started. And they have now become some of the leading scientists in Mexico, and they are mentors of the students that are students now. It's an amazing place that some of the best scientists in Mexico and in the world come to work at this biological field station. The people, the staff there are all equally amazing. And so we went back, my wife Chris and I and our kids, in 2009, and we spent part of our sabbatical there. We got to know the school, our kids went to schools, went to school there, and the people are so great, gracious and kind, and the food is incredible, and it's a really wonderful place to work. You can see, landed in 09, and we're still going back. Our son. So, we have a history there. So when I came to Central, my colleague Dr. Ely, who's in this room, I just saw her come in, we thought, let's take students and go to cool places, and we started working in Mexico. You can see it goes all the way back to 99, the first year we went there. But especially after that sabbatical, 2010, 2012, 2014, we went back and the students did these amazing research projects and they learned a ton. And at that time, 2014, we learned about this program the National Science Foundation had called the IRES program, the International Research Experience for Students, and we realized we could get funding to actually go there and spend more time and do more research in the summer and actually pay students to work with us and with our amazing mentors, Mexican mentors. So Gabe and I wrote this proposal, Dr. Stryker and I wrote an NSF proposal. This was in 2015. It was this summer, deadline is August. We had all these great ideas about how we're going to investigate the way animals deal with seasonality. We're going to look at the kissing bugs and the ticks and the parasites and the forest. And so we sent our proposal into NSF. And then Hurricane Patricia in October of 2015. Hit smack dab on our field station. This photograph here was taken October 22nd. On October 23rd, the winds in Hurricane Patricia were the highest wind speeds ever measured in a storm in the Western Hemisphere. 215 miles per hour winds. The barometric pressure dropped down to 872 millibars, lowest barometric pressure ever measured in a storm in the New World. Still much stronger than the hurricanes we experienced this year in the Caribbean, the three big hurricanes we got. It was a massive storm, and it was terrifying. By the time it hit the coast, made landfall, it reduced to a Category 4 hurricane, so the winds weren't quite as strong. But nobody died. And there were many people in our Ellensburg and CWU community that donated money to help restoration efforts to bring the field station back up and running and help people. But you can see the damage was amazing. The trees were knocked down, the buildings were damaged, the library, windows were broken out of the library. It was a major event that sort of threw our whole system on its head, in a sense. And so this last year, it took us a while to realize how important this hurricane was and how it would change the focus of our research in Mexico. And just this past spring, a group of students, including these awesome Sobre Mexico scholars that you're about to meet, went down and we learned, we have a lot of data from before, from pre-hurricane data, so we were able to look at the effects of the hurricane. And what the hurricane did was it dumped a ton of woody debris. It knocked down trees, it broke branches, and they fell out down to the forest floor and altered the understory of the forest. And you can see more woody debris has been added after the hurricane. This is based on data before and after that the students gathered. And you can see also that the canopy opened up. The broken trees let more sunlight into the forest, and that changes the temperature, the thermal regime of the forest. And so things have changed. And so it makes it, for animals, organisms, creatures that live in the forest understory, root in the forest, things have changed. Whereas before it was a little bit more open, now it's much more difficult to navigate that landscape. So before I turn it over to my awesome colleague, Gabe Stryker, I want to say some thank yous. I obviously want to thank you guys. I want to thank this amazing group of students I'm so privileged to have been able to work with. I want to thank our department and our university, because there are a lot of places you can't do this kind of thing. We have a group of people that really help make things happen here. And I especially want to thank Dr. Stryker, my co-PI, who helped make all this happen.
Hi, everybody. I'm Gabe Stryker. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the Sobre Mexico program that these students have been involved in this last year. So this seminar is to tell you about their research and also hopefully recruit next year's students, because we got this grant for 3 years. So we'll be going down again this next summer and then the summer after that. So if you are interested in this program, let me tell you what's going to happen. So applications are due this Halloween, October 31st, so it's coming up pretty quick here. And you just go online, you need to complete the application, you need your college transcripts, you know, basic stuff, a couple letters of recommendation, and submit that. And you also need to have taken biostats by 213 by spring 4th. You have to have that before you go down to And then this winter quarter, students are going to take Bio 377 Regional Natural History. And this class is about the dry tropical forest. You learn about the plants and the animals and plan out a research project for over spring break. So, and then on spring break, we'll travel down to Chinoa, the 2-hour drive to the airport in Seattle, 5-hour flight, and another 3 hours from Puerto Vallarta to the station. So it's a pretty long day to get down there. But once we're down there, it's absolutely beautiful. If you saw any of that video, that was from spring break this year when we went down. And so it's not just the Sobre Mexico students, but an entire class that goes down and we work on projects. Down there, it's warm, you know, you're leaving Ellensburg. It's in the 30s and 40s, and you get down there, and it's in the 80s, and it's really wonderful. And then in the summer, we'll go for 7 weeks in the summer. And now you're leaving windy Ellensburg, and it's warm here, and it's hot, and it's uncomfortable, and there's no air conditioning in the rooms, but it's worth it. And I hope you guys will get that sense when you're through with the presentation. So the students are going to be living at the station. These are the student dorms, the faculty dorms, the cafeteria, some of the labs and library are over here. This is the ocean out here. This is one of the student dorms. And the students are working, and they're working hard while they're down there. So for 7 weeks, they're working on their animals, doing their projects, carrying out their projects. But we have a lot of fun here. So we took off a week in the middle of the 7 weeks, and we went to Guadalajara. And we learned about the culture there. We explored the city. It's absolutely a beautiful city. We went to Volcán Colima. Unfortunately, when we went, it was cloudy. The year before when we went, it was burping. Little burst of smoke would come out every half an hour or so. We were in Tonalá, and we learned about the culture there. And they did this dance for us where they talked about when the Spanish came and they conquered the area with Guadalajara, and they reenacted that battle. And all the way through to where the warriors were killed by the Spanish. And we went a lot of other places throughout Mexico. Today we went to where the turtle rescue is, the sea turtles. This is on that property. It's this great big dome, and we went in there, and the students were racing around. It was a lot of fun. And then after you return in summer, then next year's cohort and the year after that will present this seminar. So they'll talk about their research and present their research to the department and other students. And then all the way in May 2019, then you present your research at the undergraduate research conference source. And so here are some of the several students presenting their research from last spring break. And then now I'm going to turn it over to the Sobre Mexico students. So we'll start with Cameron, and he's going to talk to you about the Mexican spotted turtle.
Hi everyone, my name is Cameron, and over the summer I got to research the Mexican spotted turtle. So a little background, the Mexican spotted turtle, also known as Rhino tamiz, Ruida paraxantha, it's actually a very rare and endemic species to the tropical forest. And the tropical forest, as you heard a little bit from Dan, was that it's very endangered. It's one of the most threatened worldwide. And so what I went down there to research was to see how the habitat of these turtles has changed. Previous research done by Taggart Butterfield, who was a student here at Central, who is actually now a PhD student at UNA, one of the biggest universities down there in Mexico. He researched how these turtles have essentially used up their habitat. And what he found was that the available habitat consisted of leaf litter, woody debris, vegetation, and tree stumps. And the tree stumps provided a sort of shelter for the turtles. And so what he found out was that these turtles preferred to be on a more of an inclined slope rather than flat ground, and they also preferred to have been on leaf litter. Also, he looked at the home range, and the home range is defined as where they are, or just essentially where they are, so what they, where they're going, traveling, eating, sleeping, mating. Anywhere that you can find them in the forest is considered part of their home range. So my questions going into this was, how did this hurricane that came through affect how the turtles use their habitat? And within that, to see if their home ranges have changed, have they gotten bigger, smaller? In Taggart's research, he found out that the females had a smaller home range than the males. And so I was going to see if there's any difference there, see if they're more inactive or active during the day, see if rain brings them out, or some kind of patterns there, and behavioral things. So are they more in groups, or are they mating more, or are they interacting more, or are they just more dormant? Yeah, and in this picture, I was gives you an idea how hard they are to find in the forest. If you look right there, kind of see that the turtle is right there. Yeah, it's very difficult to find them, and sometimes you might even step on them, but nothing got hurt in the making. So my methods, what I did did was essentially go out there and find 3 male and 3 female. That initial part of the dry season, which we were down there, which I want to say it took about a week and a half before we found all of them, but then after that we kept on finding more and more, and I recorded data such as on those turtles, like morphological data, how big their shells are, and all these other things that Taggart was wanting data on. And so essentially I would find these turtles, bring them back to the station, I would put radio transmitters on them with Mighty Putty, and then I would release them back into the wild, right where I found them. And then every single day, I would use this radiotelemetry gear and my antenna to detect where their location is. And so each time, I would go out in the forest every morning, crawl through the, you know, all this debris, and you kind of see how dense it is. I would find the turtles, I would record their location on their with the GPS, look at the slope that they were on, see if they were active or inactive, and then what kind of habitat and behaviors they exhibited. And so what I found after 6 weeks of research was that the males ended up having an average home range smaller than the females, which is opposite of what Taggart found. And you can kind of see in his figures over here that he kind of went around the field station and did all these points over here. But I'm in the process of making very similar graphs to these. But mine were more concentrated in a similar geographic area. And so some interesting findings. One really cool thing that I found out was that this turtle, Brian Fleming's Paradoxantha, is actually, we have now observed it to be an omnivore. It has previously been thought to have been an herbivore, because it's only been seen eating plants and fruits. But I was the first person ever to have seen this eating caterpillar, and that's something I could publish. And then the behavioral observations. A lot of turtle mating, which was interesting, because Taggart, for a whole year and a half, only saw one population event, and I witnessed around 4 to 5. But overall, this whole experience was more than just science. It was the culture, it was the people, it was nature, it was everything. And if I was to give like advice to anyone that's thinking about doing this, it's that you're going to be uncomfortable. There's going to be a language barrier, and you're not going to know what's going to happen. And so my advice is get comfortable with being uncomfortable, and that will make your experience so much better and so great. Up next is Jenny to talk about lizards.
Hi guys, as Cameron said, my name is Jennifer Magana, and I studied the effects of Hurricane Patricia on lizard species assemblages. So the tropical dry forest is made of many different species. I focused on these. I focused on the 3 species of whiptail lizard, the spiny lizard you see here, and a skink. These lizards are distributed among the uplands and the arroyos of the dry forest. These are the uplands here, which are they have a lot of, strongly deciduous trees, which lose their leaves throughout the dry season, and the arroyos have strong access to water, which retain their leaves throughout the year. Here we have a table. This is 2009 data that was collected by Dr. Beck. As you can see, the Spirocella foliatissima, which is here and shown here, is very abundant in the uplands, and the Mucosa cindulata is very abundant in the arroyos. Overall, this is a representation of how these lizards are distributed among the tropical dry forests before the hurricane. So my questions were, how have lizard species assemblages responded to the effects of Hurricane Patricia? And how do species assemblages differ between the uplands and the arroyos? So my methods. So the first thing I had to do was locate these different pitfalls. These pitfalls were Ornithos, Calandria, and Buo. Ornithos was back here behind this mountain. Calandria is here, and Buo is in this general location. Each of these pitfall locations had 4 different arrays. The bottom 2, 1 and 2, are the arroyos, and the top 2 or three and four, which are considered the uplands. They would go one, two, three, and four. So I would travel to each of these locations, and I would get to these pitfall traps, which are set up, as you can see here. How they work is that these lizards crawl alongside of this fence, and then they just fall into this bucket. So I would go to all of these, and then I would gather any lizards that were there, and then I would put them in these cloth bags that you see here, and I would strap them onto my backpack and then take them back to the field station. At the field station, I would take their snout to vent length, as you can see here, and then I would take their vent to the end of their tail. And I would also take their mouse. So, after all of that, after many, many hours of being out there, I put together a graph similar to the 2009 data that Dr. Beck collected. And what we noticed was that the Aspergillus leniatissima, which was more abundant in the uplands, moved into the arroyos. And the Holcosis undulata, which you see here, went from the arroyos into the uplands. So one possible reason that the ones that went from the arroyos and moved into the uplands is because there is so much debris there that they can now hide under all of it and get away from predators. The Aspergillus leniatissima, which is one that moved into the arroyos, could have moved there because their habitat has changed. There's more open canopy, and it's a more favorable habitat. Also, they have more opportunities for thermal regulation. So after all of that, I would go to Hornitos and be out there for like 2 hours, go up to Calandra, and I would have this view that you see here. So I got to watch this forest change from dry season to wet season. It was an amazing view. I would sit there and I would just get to see all of this. I could see the field station, which you see here and here. And then I was also able to see the beach on the other end. Sometimes I would want to be there because it was so hot and I'd be so sweaty, and it was just a hard work, but at the end it was all worth it, just because of this that you see here. But I couldn't have done any of this alone. I got to work with some amazing people, some Mexican students. This is one of Dr. Garcia's students. His name is Rafa. We actually caught a beaded lizard in one of our traps, and Dr. Beck had never caught any beaded lizard in the trap, which was amazing. The people that I went with also helped me out. They would go out with me, they would sweat with me, and do all the work with me, and it was just amazing. I couldn't have done it without them. One of the other things that I got to learn there was just my own culture. I am Hispanic, and it kind of opened my eyes to all of that. I got to work with kids and show them everything I've learned about the lizards. Some of them recognize some of the lizards that I work with because they're just in their everyday lives. And they were so happy that we were able to show them all of this. The other thing that I thought was amazing was that I was able to teach my own culture to these amazing students. They opened their eyes, and I felt like they were able to kind of be able to get themselves out there. I pushed them, I think, a lot. Sometimes they didn't want to talk Spanish, but I was just like, oh, they know Spanish, go talk to them. So, yeah, it was really amazing. I watched them grow and learn and be a part of my own culture as well. Thank you. So now, Taylor.
Jenny is really sweet. She didn't tell you guys that she would bring extra water to dump on the lizards when they were caught instead of drinking it herself. So you got in there. This summer, I studied the poisonous and most feared toad in Mexico, but when we spend a lot of time with them, they're actually really cute. My name is Taylor Henney, and I'm going to share all of my adventures of great attracting pink toads in the tropical dry forest. So a little background information on cane toads. They are these great big toads that have these big glands behind their head that secrete glucotoxin, which is poisonous in order to defend themselves from predators. They're called hamburguesas in Mexico because they are just massive. And they're famous invasive species in Australia. And what's great about my project is not only did I get to be one of the first people to study them in the tropical dry forest, but I studied them in their native habitat in Mexico. So What does the population look like at the field station? How much do they weigh? How big are they? I was also curious about how you can manage this intense seasonality of the tropical dry forest and not having water for such a long time, as well as how did Hurricane Patricia impact the cane toad? So what I did was I measured and weighed all the cane toads that I found in the forest and at the field station, and then we chose four, two from the field station and two from the forest. And I did surgery on them, and we surgically implanted radio transmitters as well as data loggers so that I could find these creatures out in the forest. So we put them back where we found them, and then every day I would try and find them. It was really difficult, but I'd go out, I'd obtain their location, and I could also take the temperature of them with the radio telemetry equipment. So here's the field station, and these are my little toadies. This is Mina. She is my baby. She's the first toad that I did surgery on. She hangs out right outside the kitchen, the best spot. And here's Santo. Santo hangs out. He stays right in front of the water tower. There's a little concrete slab that he hides inside of. And then this is Tiny and Quake, who are somewhere different every day out in the forest. So what does a day in the life of a cane toad look like? It looks a little something like this. They're hiding in their shelter for most of the day, so their temperature is gradually increasing as the temperature outside increases. And then when rain comes, or about at night, 9 or 10 o'clock, they'll come out of their shelters and they'll immediately cool down because it's much cooler outside at night. And this is when they're foraged, so they'll stay out there and they'll capture beetles. So here's a glimpse of what it looks like to radio track cane toads. You are trekking through the forest, you're bleeding, you're getting poked, you're bruised up. In the wet season it's a little bit nicer because the leaves carry water. And you do a happy dance every time you can find one of these toads. So I made some awesome discoveries about how cane toads can maintain water balance. The first of which is that they take refuge in these fallen balsamic trees from Hurricane Patricia. So these trees were knocked down in these high winds, and Dr. Beck and I went out the first day and found the toad inside this tree that stores water. And we didn't know that there was any connection between cane toads and the hurricanes. Nobody did research on them before. They also leave their shelters to forage during the rain. So they'll go to the same light at the field station. Every night they'll be sitting out by the same light and they'll be capturing the beetles. So you'll walk around and you'll see all the same toads at their home. And Santo has a girlfriend and they sit out by the same light together every night for hours. And they'll capture beetles together. I'll play some romantic music for them. They also are very, very opportunistic. So they find these little spots that will drip water on. They accumulate in these little cuddle puddles, and they all sit together and take turns being dripped on, and they cool off that way. So I left Mexico with countless bug bites. I got peed on almost every single day by a toad, but the memories I made and the experiences I've gained doing field work are worth a lifetime of bug bites. The people that I met from everybody in Guadalajara teaching the school kids about toads. I'm like, you don't need to be afraid of these. They're nice. They're cute. And we ran into a jaguar in the middle of the forest at night. And we also got to release these endangered turtles into the water. So once in a lifetime opportunity, really, really unique times here. And this is not just my sobering Mexico my Sobre Mexico family, and I am so, so, so glad and honored to be serving my family outside the United States. So I'm going to put the spotlight on Stacy now, who's going to tell you about some amphibian life.
Hi, y'all. My name is Stacy, and I study the interaction of amphibians with the pond structure within the tropical dry forest. So a little bit of background. Amphibians are in danger of becoming extinct. The tropical dry forest is one of the most endangered terrestrial ecosystems in the entire world, and the combination of both of those goes to show that it's very important to understand how amphibians interact with their environment. Here is a game tree frog, one of the species that I studied down in Mexico, and I am on. I had the privilege of working with Dr. Garcia, my Mexican mentor, and some of his students, one of which was Phoebe, pictured here. Dr. Garcia had collected some data on ponds from before the hurricane, and I helped analyze that data set. And we found some interesting patterns that are crucial to understanding how amphibians interact with their environment. One of those was hydroperiod. Hydroperiod is the length of time it takes for a pond to dry up, which is very important for amphibians because when they reproduce, they want the eggs to survive. So as you can see here, as the hydroperiod increased, the number of amphibians found at each pond also increased, only to a point, which is about the 30-day mark, which makes sense because depending on the species, it takes about a couple weeks to 30 days for amphibians to go from to metamorphosize from an egg all the way to a juvenile to be able to crawl out of the pond. After about 50 days, there's really no preference for a longer pond period. So my research consisted of seeing how the woody debris affected the pond structure within the forest. So Hurricane Patricia, as you've seen in a previous slide, dumped a ton of woody debris into the forest. And I was looking at how that woody debris would affect the ponds, affect the pond structure, the abundance of the ponds, the hydroperiod, which in turn, how does that affect the amphibians living there? I went out with Phoebe into the forest and mapped some of the same ponds that Dr. Garcia did, and found some interesting data. So here, with less rain, there's a smaller hydroperiod, which is bad for the amphibians because then the eggs will dry up before they can fully develop. But if we have too much rain, then these rivers form within the forest and it actually washes out all the ponds. And so there's really a happy medium that we need, a sweet spot in the middle of a steady rainfall throughout the entire rainy season. Unfortunately, this season the rains came late and we actually had a very dry couple of weeks when we were down there. And so I wasn't able to fully analyze how woody debris affects the pond structure within the forest, but I laid a very good groundwork for research next year, which I hope future survey scholars will be able to build upon and look at the effects. And like everybody has mentioned, it's so much more than the research. I had just so much fun diving into the culture, meeting new people, and I sucked at Spanish going down. I had 2 years in high school, but I learned a lot, and everybody was so gracious with me. And yeah, this whole team has become my family, as Taylor has said. And ultimately, I learned that research is not exactly what I thought. I thought I was going to go down and have a straightforward experiment and, you know, get these data and, you know, get this result and it'll be easy. But nature is very unpredictable, especially the tropical dry forest is very unpredictable. And I think that's one of the most valuable lessons that I learned, that research is all about adapting to your surroundings. Now I'm going to invite Lily up.
Way of collecting these ticks, so I did research, and there were some where they would do CO2 traps, but those were used more for open grass field, so it wouldn't really work in the forest that's not so open because of all the woody debris that we dumped. So the method I chose, I chose to use was the dragging method. And this is where you take this flannel felt sheet and you drag it across bushes, trails, and the floor, I don't know. And you collect ticks that are in. The reason I chose to use that is because ticks are known to use what is called questing, where they climb to the top of a plant, grass, side of the bushes, and they wait there with like their legs sticking out for a host to come by and brush up against them, and they'll attach themselves. So the flannel sheet here represents a host brushing up against the plants, and the ticks would attach themselves to it. So after dragging for so many meters, I would bag these flannel sheets up in Ziploc bags and label them whether they were upland or arroyo and how many meters I had dragged for. I'd go back to the station, I would lay the flannel sheet out on the floor and just look at it to see if I could see any movement. Ticks are really, really tiny, so sometimes it was really hard to see any movement, but when I did see the ticks, I would pull them off with tweezers and stick them in microcentrifuge tubes filled with alcohol to kill them. And I would store them and let the alcohol do its process. And afterwards, I would grab the microcentrifuge tubes again, and I would take them to the lab where I would look at them under the microscope to look for life stage and species type. And in doing so, I looked at certain characteristics that the ticks had in order to identify them. So the three life stages I was looking for was larva, nymph, and adult. So as you can see in the top left picture of the square, the larva was identified because they have three legs on each side, so six legs in total. It's really easy. The nymph has four legs on each side, so eight legs total. And to tell the difference between a nymph and an adult, because they both have eight legs total, adults have this hard body covering called the scutum, which the nymphs lack. So that's how I was able to identify them. And I also had an identification key to identify species type based on what their scutum looked like and mouthpieces. These ticks here were ticks that were pulled off the toes, and the reason they look so like huge is because they had just gotten some blood. Well, I just pulled them off toes, so they had blood. So during spring when I went with some of my colleagues and we worked on the ticks, we looked at distribution patterns, and we found that nymphs were most abundant in the upland versus the arroyo, which had far less. And adults were solely found in the arroyos, with none being found in the upland. So then the questions for the summer led to how the distribution patterns were going to change during the wet season, because we sampled during the dry season, and if there was going to be any new tick species found during the wet season, because we only found one type of tick species during spring, which was the cayenne tick. So my results I used the exact same method during spring, the dragging method, for summer, and my results showed that the nymphs favored the arroyos, with 106 being found in there, and the uplands had far less. I only found one adult tick dragging, but there were plenty of them found on toads. But as far as dragging, there was only one found in the arroyo. And here, the larvas, there was 208 found in the upland, and the spike in that is due to, on one of my drags, I hit a batch of ticks, so females had laid their eggs, and they had just hatched, well, maybe not just, but had hatched, and in one sweep, I had collected 206. Which is why the numbers spiked up all the way in there. They were really tiny. I thought they were specks of dirt, so I thought I just went out and got my flannel dirty. But yeah, they're really tiny, and I had to pull each and every single one of them off with a tweezer and stick them in a tube. And I also observed that there was ticks. I don't know if you can see, but those orange spots, those are ticks found on lizards, and they're in clusters, so you don't really see a lizard with one or two ticks. You usually see them with 20, 50, and so forth. So that's a great opportunity for future research, you know, to see the parasite-host interaction between ticks on lizards or even the ticks that we found on the toads. So So my, when comparing the distribution patterns, that's what I was looking, distribution patterns between dry season and wet season. These are the two graphs, one for dry and the other for the left. And as you can see, the distribution pattern changed in the wet season because the nymphs now had favored the arroyo versus when I did it during the dry season, they had favored the upland. We found zero adults in the upland for both dry and wet season, and only one during the wet, which isn't really that significant, but we found one. And, well, the nymphs were found mostly in the upland, and we only found one in the upland during spring. So, this trip taught me a lot. It taught me, well, with my research first, it taught me to be patient. I am very impatient, and there's a lot of thorns on the bushes. So when you're dragging, and Dr. Shriver and Dr. Beck know this, when we're dragging, your flannel gets caught on, like, all the thorns, and you're trying to yank at it. So most of my flannels had holes in them by the time I was done. And I also learned a lot about the different traditions, beliefs, culture that is up there, and just learned to embrace a little more. I was also able to create a lot of friendships. Most of these, so these students here, these four, some students would come in and they're only there for like a week, 7 days, and then they leave. But within those 7 days, you're with them for so, like, so much time, you spend so much time with them that you create a friendship that's, we're still in touch now and stuff, but you create friendships faster there, I noticed, than what you do here. But, and also, my favorite part was the children. If you don't know me, I really love kids. And if you didn't know, if you were with me in Mexico, you found that out within like the first 2 days. I enjoyed going to the school and meeting the kids and learning and teaching them about what I was learning, as well as playing soccer with them, basketball, patty cake. And oftentimes when we go to the beach, if there was other kids there, I would just randomly walk up to kids and be like, hey, what are you doing? Build sandcastles with them. And it was just a great experience to see how inviting the people are there and how welcoming they are and loving and open. And it was great to see that and experience that for a whole summer and just be around what I love most, which is kids. So now I'm going to hand it off to Sam, who's going to talk about his work with TriTech.
Amigos y familia, my name is Samuel Gutierrez. I'm Sam Gutierrez. I'm here to talk to you guys about my behavioral analysis with Triatomo Bolivari in the tropical dry forest. This is the beautiful creature. Sorry, it's like my hands better. This is a beautiful creature I worked with right here, the insect parasite Triatomo Bolivari. It's a vector of Chagas disease, and for those of you who don't know, Chagas disease is on the World Health Organization's list of most neglected tropical diseases. The Triatomo vector cohabitates with humans in rural environments. That's typically where the jungle meets the villages. I'm sorry, jungles or forests meet villages and small towns. And it feeds on blood. This is hematophagous. It's not a predatory bug. Doesn't typically kill its prey. But yeah, it just feeds on blood. And Chagas, in particular, it affects all mammals and humans. All of us sitting here today are mammals. So just to give a little bit of background for my study. So to start working with these insects, we built what we very nicely named, I gotta thank Dan Beck for helping me name this thing, the Triatomatron. It's a very, very fancy word to describe an insect terrarium. This is screen that I use right here. I chose screen to give the insects full mobility. I didn't want any behavioral limitations. That is, they could land and fly and run on the walls, ceilings, anything that they wanted. So thigmotaxis, phototaxis, very scientific, fancy words. Thigmo means touch, taxis means to gravitate towards. So these guys really like nooks, crannies, any cracks in housing panes, so shingles and things like that. So in order to try to recreate a homey environment for these bugs, I made this synthetic board with a bunch of grooves and stuff. You later find out that they hated that. phototaxis is similar to thigmotaxis, but just the gravitation towards light. So that was my main focus here, was looking at light preferences of these bugs to see if they loved or hated any specific light, maybe even bare down to wavelength was my hope. And then, obviously, first, I couldn't lure them in here. You see our first inhabitant of the Tritomatron Hotel. And I had to catch them. I had to roam around the field station. This involved roaming around the field station at the wee hours of the morning, creepily, with my headlight, checking dorms, the outside, not the inside, of faculty buildings, and also setting entomological light traps, just a buzzing light with the sheet. I set those at the edge of the forest and around the field station. I did catch a bunch of them, but they were dying, so I had to make some modifications. I just sort of had to roll with the punches here. Some of the things that I did to sort of curb that death rate, I increased water availability. Go figure, they don't like to die of dehydration. And I also included this natural hiding place, which, as you can see, very close-up picture here. This is a log. I found a log and threw it in there. A lot of nooks, a lot of crannies. There's a little under tunnel in there. And after I ripped out that artificial junk, they loved it. This all helped me prevent overheating. That was my goal, to keep them alive and healthy so that I could analyze their behaviors and get some data. But I think the biggest point here is reducing light exposure. Now, if you saw in the picture before, I had the lights sort of on top of my triatomatron, and it was just bearing down on them. So I'm looking for light preferences, but they didn't have to move anywhere to show preference. They were getting light wherever they were. So Dr. Stryker and I sort of had a breakthrough. We obscured the lights for them. That is, we put it in a just tiny little corner of the triatomatron, and this was like almost immediate response from these bugs. It was great, like a cat to a laser pointer. But the only, this is a pretty good little depiction. So I would do this for a couple of minutes, and then we'd come and count them, flick the light on. We're looking at the same corner here. So same corner, and you can see they're all over here. You know? And none of them were on the other side of it. So this was great to find this sort of experimental methodology breakthrough to get some responsive data and things like that. But it was only towards the tail end of my experiment. It was towards the tail end of my experiment that I figured out I had been frying the sport bugs. So 6 days left to gather this data. I stayed up. Taylor helped me so much. We stayed up sometimes 3 to 6 a.m. in the morning, just like plugging in data, watching these bugs, observing behaviors. And this is more or less what I got. So this is a graph that shows all the different lights that I use and percent attracted. So how many tritoma in the triatomatron were attracted to the light. And essentially what I found out was that they just love light. So, I mean, nothing groundbreaking here. But I'm very proud to say that my work here could be used in future potential research. Absolutely. You know, helping somebody else by establishing, hey, this is how you get them to react. And that way that kid, day one, maybe one of you scientists listening, young scientists listening to this, day one, you know what to do. So a couple of other things I kind of looked at too. Activity during the night. So I logged activity during the night, heat attraction, CO2 attraction, attraction to other insects. This was all just sort of an effort, secondary objectives, an effort to get them to move and get them to show me something. But nothing too encrypting there. All in all, the scientific aspect and like getting out there and being able to use your things that you're learning in biology classes and biostats, it was all amazing. But I don't think future Sam could have ever prepared past Sam for the cultural experience that he was going to embark upon. The cultural experience was absolutely incredible. 5 minutes here, it doesn't even come close, guys. It doesn't come close to what I need to tell you about everything that happened. Everything was so amazing, and I know I sound like Donald Trump, but the people, the culture, the subcultures, the unspoken bond of a handshake that meant you were going to be there when you said you would, you were going to work with this Mexican carpenter that you just met, and when you said you would, and give or take 5 minutes or so, because the Mexicans are. No, I mean you have to engage us. We have a Q&A period. You have to engage us. You have to ask us about the eyes of the little school children as this team of awesome young scientists comes through bearing critters from abroad. Ask me about releasing baby sea turtles, helping release baby sea turtles by headlight at 12 in the morning or 12 at night, midnight. Fireflies and sea turtles. Ask me about engaging a tribal leader in deep philosophical conversation and having him gift me his ceremonial weapon. Ask me about that, please. And the honor that came with it is incredible. So I can't, unfortunately, go into every aspect of my journey and my trip and what changed all of our lives, but to come close, just to come close, I would start by using the words inviting, invigorating, vibrant, and unequivocally impactful. Thank you.